Hey folks, welcome back. I've been trying to get into shape, so I've taken up running. And I put the packages on my back to make it a little more difficult. I mean, this is my first day doing it, but I think it's going pretty well. I've made it from all the way over there, so I don't really remember what I was gonna say, so I'm just gonna.
Hideo Kojima, without a doubt one of the biggest names in the video game industry. He is of course best known for his 30-year tenure with Konami, during which he spearheaded the creation of many classics such as Police Knots, Django Unchained, and Penguin Adventure. But for real, Metal Gear. Kojima's the Metal Gear guy. He's basically single-handedly responsible for giving Konami their most successful franchise. Metal Gear basically established the stealth genre in the 80s and then modernized it and refined it with the release of the 1998 PlayStation title, Metal Gear Solid. And of course, the rest is history. Metal Gear went on to become a huge multi-installment franchise, with Kojima involved in the development of every one in some way or another. And outside his flagship series, he was involved in the development and or production of other Konami releases, essentially positioning himself as the face of the company. However, this is Konami we're talking about, and they don't operate like the average company. Take note of these two images. Now, if you're a normal person, you probably see a foot and a gun, but Konami, they see an opportunity. On August 12, 2014, Kojima, in collaboration with film director Guillermo del Toro, known for Pan's Labyrinth and Hellboy, released PT onto the PlayStation Network. Despite only clocking in at around half an hour to 45 minutes, PT immediately turned everyone on the internet into private investigators, because it basically gave you zero indication as to what you were supposed to do. It was just a seemingly never-ending stroll through this repeating corridor that progressively becomes more horrifying as you go through. But those who actually managed to read Hideo Kojima's mind and zoom in on all the right places were presented with this. Holy shit. Yeah, that's right, it was all a ruse. That entire 45-minute game was just a playable teaser for Silent Hills, starring Norman Reedus for some reason. An all-new Silent Hill game directed by Hideo Kojima in collaboration with Guillermo del Toro? It seemed too good to be true. It was too good to be true. Yeah, Konami canceled Silent Hills almost immediately after its reveal, because of course they did. This was kind of the beginning of the end for Konami and Kojima. After almost 30 years of being the mascot of the company, Konami thanked him by not only canceling Silent Hills, but removing the name of his production company from Metal Gear Solid 5, and disallowing him from attending an award ceremony to accept an award for the game. Understandably, Kojima left Konami and re-established Kojima Productions as an independent studio, and at E3 2016, we got a peek at his upcoming project.
Soon I'll come around. Lost and never found.
So yeah, really the only thing that the trailer revealed to the onlookers was that the game was titled Death Stranding. I like this trailer because it really shows the sheer amount of value that Hideo Kojima's name has on a project. My man can drop a reveal trailer that gives nothing about what the game is, and everyone gets hype as shit regardless, because it's the Metal Gear guy. Over the next few years, more trailers were dropped about Death Stranding that didn't really help to elucidate what the game was, apart from showing that Guillermo del Toro and Mads Mikkelsen was in it, and also the angry video game nerd. But regardless, everyone was hype as hell for Death Stranding, including myself, and eventually that fateful day came. On November 8th, 2019, Death Stranding was released on the PlayStation 4. I went absolutely crazy when this game came out, and I actually went to a store and purchased Death Stranding for full price. That's how excited I was. I took it home, brimming with excitement. I put it in my PS4 and sat down to start it up.
This is going to be a good video game.
And then I played it.
This is a good video game.
And then I played it some more.
I think this is a good video game.
And then I played it a lot more.
I don't think this is a good video game.
Yeah, I didn't like Death Stranding when it came out. Like, at all, really. Which is kind of a tough pill to swallow. I mean, I was excited for this game for years. I love Hideo Kojima. And I'm also a big fan of Guillermo del Toro, Mads Mikkelsen, and even though Norman Reedus is most closely associated with the worst tragedy humankind has ever seen, he's a really good actor. An underrated one at that. But it's been almost 2 years since Death Stranding came out. And in that time period, I've heard lots of people talk about how much they appreciate it. Especially considering it came out right at the end of 2019, before, you know, that thing happened. But you know what, I've decided to give Death Stranding another chance. So without further introduction, let's hop right into walking to 7-Eleven to get cigarettes in Alaska Simulator. You start up the game and you're greeted by this crazy CGI cutscene, and it makes you think, holy shit, this game is gonna be insane. And then you realize that this is just the Kojima Productions logo. Look at the ass on this guy. This really is a Hideo Kojima game. So the plot of Death Stranding is confusing as hell, and rather than explaining all the logistics of the world as I go, it's easier to just give a summary up top. So here we go. Death Stranding takes place in a post-apocalyptic United States, where a cataclysmic event known as the Death Stranding caused invisible monsters called BTs to start roaming Earth. BTs are entirely invisible unless A, you are carrying a bridge baby, a little fetus in a jar that somehow has the ability to detect them, or B, are blessed with a medical condition called Dooms, which allows you to sense, see, or sometimes even control BTs. BTs used to basically only exist on beaches, which in Death Stranding terminology refers to this sort of purgatory zone exclusive to every individual person. BTs also bring with them Timefall, a special kind of rain that causes anything it touches to undergo rapid aging. And also, if a BT consumes a human, which they really like doing, it triggers a void out, which is basically a giant explosion. As a result of all this nonsense, the population has been confined to cities away from BT territory. And of course, there are several loosely organized criminal terrorist groups that hang out in camps all over the place. And that's as thorough as I'm willing to be. I got a life to live. I'm not spending it sitting here trying to wrap my head around the nonsense story of Death Stranding. The game starts up and we meet our main protagonist, Sam Porter Bridges, portrayed by Norman Reedus, the father of Mingus Reedus. I'm not joking, he really honestly named his human child Mingus. Sam is a porter, essentially a delivery man. Although given that the world has clearly turned into a living hell where outside is dangerous, being a delivery man is a much more respectable position than in real life. On that note, I'd like to give a special shout out to the UPS and FedEx drivers out there. Thank you guys so much for sitting in the middle of the road with your four-ways on blocking traffic. What would we do without you? Sam's on his motorcycle when it starts raining. The game shows off the effect of Timefall by showing a drop hitting Sam's hair, turning it gray instantly. And later on, a drop lands on his hand and causes his skin to wrinkle on the spot it hit. It's pretty cool as a concept, honestly. Anyway, Sam puts his hood up and starts zooming when he's forced to bail off after colliding with a short-haired blonde woman. Although conveniently for her, she disappears right before he hits her. Inconveniently for Sam, however, his bike falls off a cliff, so he decides to take refuge in a cave to wait out the timefall. We are then introduced to Fragile, portrayed by French actress Léa Seydoux. Or Seydou, maybe, I don't know, I'm not from that part of Canada. She eats an insect in the most disgusting way possible, expositions about Timefall, and then disappears. Later on, Sam goes on a corpse disposal mission with this guy, Igor, and based on the fact that he's thus far the only character who isn't given an actor credit when he's introduced, I'm sure you can assume how well this mission is going to go. Yeah, the boys get BT'd, causing a void out to happen, and Sam gets transported to his beach. And we are subjected to, or blessed with, depending on your preference, naked Norman Reedus for the first time. but it won't be the last time. He follows a lady in a red dress into the water and then falls under, which demonstrates that Sam is a repatriate, meaning that he can come back to life after going to his beach. We then cut to Sam waking up in some sort of facility where we meet Deadman, portrayed by the voice of Jesse Corti in the likeness of Guillermo del Toro. Deadman tells Sam that he needs him to bring morphine to the President of the United States, who is in the final stages of cancer. Why can't he do it himself? Because he's a hologram. Most of the people in this game are holograms. Once we get there, Deadman explains to Sam that the President was essentially his adoptive mother, because obviously he didn't already know that. We go into the President's office where we are introduced to tall, masked, and handsome over here.
That's the President's right-hand man, the Director of Bridges.
Die Hard Man.
Oh, you were with Bridges One? So, I guess no introductions are necessary.
Wait, hold up. We're just going to gloss over the fact that that guy's actual name is Die Hard Man? So anyway, the President dies Hard Man, and it's up to us to incinerate her body so that she doesn't explode. Some more plot happens, and eventually we're given the main objective of the game. The President's daughter, who is going to eventually become the President, is being held captive in California, so Sam has to progressively reconnect the United Cities of America, city by city, to get them back onto what they call the chiral network, which essentially allows communication between the cities. So that's an introduction to the game's storyline. Obviously, there's a hell of a lot more to it than that. Also, I wanted to get to Die Hard Man, because his name is stupid as hell and I wanted to make a joke about it. But I think it's about time we looked at the gameplay, because much like the plot, it's really weird. So let's just slowly walk right in. So according to Kojima, this is the first Strand-type game. Honestly, I'm not sure if even he knows what the fuck that means. Well, based on my experience with Death Stranding, I can only assume that a Strand-type game means that it's a walking simulator, because that's what Death Stranding is, a walking simulator. You put packages on your back and you walk to your destination to deliver the packages. Now, yes, that sounds easy when you say it like that, but presumably as a result of the apocalypse, the entire United States of America has regressed back to what I imagine it looked like back when there wasn't sidewalks, so going to the store was a lot harder. Death Stranding is built around making walking as realistic as possible. Norman Reedus can't just mosey on down to the UPS office because the way to get there is full of obstacles like rocks and mountains and rivers and stuff. On top of that, you have a weight limit that drastically affects how easy it is to walk. If you're overloaded, you can't walk as fast. If your center of balance is off, you'll routinely lean to one side, necessitating you to hold one of the trigger buttons to balance yourself. Sam can climb up mountainous areas, but only to an extent, and you kind of risk falling off and damaging your packages. If you hit R1, your little shoulder sensor will scan the area and show you how difficult the terrain is. Blue is easily traversable, yellow might give you some trouble, and red is just straight up a rock. You can't walk on that. It also shows how deep the water is, so you can kind of plan whether or not it's worth it to just trudge through the water rather than using one of your ladders. As a result of this, you have an arsenal of tools that you can bring with you. You can use ladders to more easily climb up slopes and mountains, or you can use them to create a little bridge to get across troubled water. That's a joke for my baby boomers out there. I love you guys. Also climbing anchors, which you basically need to get down mountains. The trade-off, however, is the fact that everything you bring with you, including tools, adds to your weight. So you don't want to bring too many of them, especially if the cargo you need for the mission is really heavy and or far away. Now, of course, the terrain is not the only obstacle in the way. You also have mule camps, which are full of terrorist guys who steal your packages, and they have sensors all around their territory that ping when you enter. And of course, there are the sections with the BTs. As I mentioned earlier, BTs are floaty particle ghosts that appear in areas with timefall. Whenever you're going through BT territory, you have to sneak through so as not to be detected by them. Your little shoulder sensor friend comes in handy again here. It points at BTs and reacts differently based on how close you are. And if you hit the R1 button to scan the terrain, it'll show you the BTs for a second or two. Since the version of Dooms that Sam has only lets him detect BTs, you also have a bridge baby on your chest that lets you actually see them. It makes sense that Kojima would have a strong grasp on stealth gameplay given his previous works. BTs have really sensitive hearing, so you have to be quiet. But you also want to get through as quickly as possible because the timefall damages your packages. Pretty early on, though, this guy, Hartman, informs Sam that since he has Dooms, his bodily fluids are harmful to the BTs, so you can start making weapons that drain your blood to fight them. This also means that when you use the shower or the toilet in your safe room,
nice.
It creates grenades that you can use as weapons to use against the BTs. Why are you looking at me like that? You think I made that up? It's really impressive to me the sheer amount of Norman Reedus nudity that Kojima has given us. They really just give you a close-up of his ass every single time you take a shower. Although that is as far as they'll go. Show us Norman Reedus' dick, you cowards! The other obstacle in Death Stranding are the mules. They have big areas of the map claimed as their territory, and sometimes you have to go through it to get to your destination. So I mean, in theory, you'd want to plan your route around the mule camps. But honestly, it's not worth worrying about, because these dudes are perhaps the least threatening enemy I have ever encountered in a video game. I'm talking sub-Goomba here. Despite them being criminals, they seem to adhere to a strictly non-lethal moral code. Actually, it probably has to do with the fact that if they kill you, your body will explode, killing all of them, so I guess that makes sense. They have these like electrical spear things that they throw at you, but they always throw them in front of you, so all it takes to avoid them is a little bit of reaction time. Plus, like, even if they catch up to you, I mean, they try their best. You can't clown a guy for trying, you know? Once you get the ability to make these bola guns, it's all over for these guys. Like, I mean, worst case scenario, they hit you and knock off a package, but you can just run over and grab it again. To be fair, later on, there are actual terrorist groups, and these guys will actually try to kill you. But even still, they're not difficult to deal with. Norman Reedus can't be taken out by a few measly bullets. So yeah, when it comes to obstacles in Death Stranding, there's only really the BTs and the terrain itself. And with the BTs only showing up every now and again in rainstorms, the main antagonist of this game is the ground. So how do you defeat the ground? Well, as the game goes on and you complete missions, you unlock new things that you can fabricate at the various terminals using materials that you've picked up. This includes stuff like ladders and climbing anchors, but also more advanced stuff like motorcycles and trucks, robotic leg attachment things that drastically raise your max carry weight, little floating drones that carry packages for you, and this keeps going well into the game. Hours in, you're still being given new schematics to make new stuff. Probably the most important things that you can build are structures. You can build bridges, watchtowers that serve no purpose whatsoever, post boxes to drop off lost cargo, mushroom-looking things that protect you from timefall and repair your packages, and zip lines that basically let you skip the entire game. This all feeds into the online aspect of this game. Death Stranding is a completely online game, but you never once encounter another player. Instead, everything you do affects the game for other people playing it, and vice versa. Once you connect a waypoint to the chiral network, you unlock the ability to use other players' structures, vehicles, ladders, climbing anchors, etc. You'll be walking through some timefall or something, and like a guardian angel, you'll see that another player has left a timefall shelter and you can use it to repair your packages. Or you'll be walking on a mission, you'll come across a bike that somebody dropped off and you can hop on it to get to your destination faster. It also works as a sort of reward for progressing through the game, because before you arrive at the little distribution centers or whatever, it's tough because you gotta make your way through the shitty terrain with just what you have on you. But once that area is connected to the network, you walk out and you find ladders and climbing anchors and stuff. It also helps to legitimize the story as well. Sure, Bridges wants you to reconnect the United States so that you can save the president or whatever, but who cares, bro? I want to reconnect the United States so that I can use this guy's Evangelion motorcycle. This is, in my opinion, the coolest thing about Death Stranding. Everybody playing this game is working together to make each other's experiences easier. It really feeds into the game's overall theme of connecting with other people. Regardless of how alone the game makes you feel, since you're, you know, alone, it also gives you this sense of connection with other players. You don't feel bad about doing something like leaving a motorcycle somewhere or using up one of your ladders to get across a waterway, because you know it'll help someone else. Like, for example, there's this one mission where you have to get packages that are on both sides of this big lake. One is on one side, the other three are on the other. The problem is you can't get across this lake because the water is too deep, and you also can't build a bridge because it says deep water detected. Yep, I'm aware. That's why I want to put a bridge there. So yeah, being that it's in a canyon, this means that you have to climb down, collect one package, climb all the way back up, walk all the way around, climb down, and collect the other three. Since this mission is such a pain in the ass, I decided that I would make it easier for future players by setting up a zipline system. Purely just because I'm a nice guy. Now you can just easy peasy. That didn't benefit me at all, but the game fosters this sense of camaraderie with other people to the point where you want to leave stuff around to help out others. Plus, like, it was on the way, so I mean, whatever, no biggie. That said, I do have a few beefs with the gameplay of Death Stranding. There's a lot of items that really serve no purpose or are just made useless by other items, like the speed skeleton. Why would I use this? If I want to get somewhere quickly, I'll just use the motorcycle. Sure, I might bump into some rocks, but in general, you can make it in most terrain. You're way better off just using the power skeleton, which drastically increases your maximum weight limit. And then there's the weapons. Every time you unlock a schematic to fabricate a gun, you also get one that shoots rubber bullets that just knock enemies out. Why on earth would I ever want to use a gun that actually kills people? If you kill anybody in this game, you have to dispose of their body to prevent it from causing a void out. And on top of that, the non-lethal guns can be equipped with hematic bullets that drain some of your blood that you can use to fight the BTs. There's no benefit to having actual guns. On the note of combating the BTs, you progressively unlock weapons that you can use to fight the spooky ghost monsters. Now let me hit you with a tough decision. You can either equip guns that kill the BTs in a few hits, piss and shit grenades that just distract them and don't actually kill them, or you can use hematic grenades, which take up almost no space in your inventory and kill them in one hit. Why the fuck would I use anything other than hematic grenades? The BTs are always in stealth sections, and you only really want to kill them when absolutely necessary. So why would you want to use something that aggravates them and doesn't automatically kill them? But you know what? Those are just minor things that I found kind of stupid. They don't really negatively affect the gameplay at all. I mean, when you have this many items, I guess some of them are bound to negate others. I just think it's kind of weird that they give you the insta-kill weapon before the guns instead of the other way around, but whatever. Now, if you've ever played a Hideo Kojima game, you would know that simply looking at the gameplay isn't gonna cut it. All of Kojima's games are huge, epic, theatrical, movie-game hybrids. In fact, Metal Gear Solid 4 currently holds the Guinness World Record for the longest cutscene in a video game at 71 minutes. Jesus Christ, man, just make a movie at that point. But Death Stranding is no exception. It's a very story-driven game, so it would be doing it a disservice to just look at the gameplay. So let's examine the storyline aspect of the game. I hope you got some Tylenol handy. So I already went over the plot of the game in general. You are Sam Porter Bridges, the son of the recently deceased president of the UCA, Bridget Strand, and your goal is to make it from Capital Knot City on the East Coast all the way to Edge Knot City on the West Coast, where Amelie, Sam's sister, who was captured during her expedition to reconnect the UCA and the chiral network, is being held. All the while, you want to reconnect the UCA just like she was trying to do. You also have an entire gang of homies helping you out along the way. You got Fragile, a mysterious woman who works for Fragile Express. Like Sam, she has dooms, but hers is stronger to the point where she actually has the ability to teleport and can see BTs, unlike Sam, who can only sense them. Deadman, a scientist who mostly serves the purpose of explaining the functionality of the baby you carry around in a jar in your chest. Die Hardman, played by Tommy Earl Jenkins, the director of Bridges, the company Sam works for. He's basically like the colonel from Metal Gear Solid in that he just kind of keeps Sam in the loop about everything. Mama, played by Margaret Qualley, the obligatory girl engineer character who gives Sam all the deets about equipment and technology and stuff. And she has an infant BT that she looks after, hence the name Mama. And Hartman, a dashing Englishman who's like a weapons expert. He contacts you about anti-BT guns and the piss grenades and stuff. And then on the other side, you got the bad guys. Higgs, played by Troy Baker, who's pretty much the main antagonist of the game, at least for the first half. And Clifford Unger, played by Mads Mikkelsen, who I can't really get into because he's introduced so late in the game that any aspect of his character is pretty much a spoiler. Obviously, the characters are a lot more in-depth than that. Most of them go through character development arcs through the game, but it kind of borders on spoiler territory, so I'm just gonna stay as far away from that as possible. Now, here lies one of my major criticisms with Death Stranding. There is way too much goddamn talking in this game. And look, I'm not gonna sit here and be like story-driven video game bad, because I don't think that. Obviously, I wouldn't be a fan of Kojima's if I did. And the story of Death Stranding is very engaging. I'm not complaining about the full-on cinematic cutscenes, and I find the characters very interesting, even if they drop the occasional stupid-ass one-liner. What I mean when I say there's too much talking is the sheer amount of unimportant, expository bullshit dialogue in this game. The characters explain everything to you, repeatedly, ad nauseam. They never stop talking to you about shit that you already know. Much like in Metal Gear, the characters can get in contact with you via a codec. Although, to this game's credit, a lot of the time when they call you, they just talk to you while you're walking rather than interrupting the game. Every character has a unique ringtone. Die Hardman's is... Deadman's is... Mama's is... Hartman's is... Why would you include Chopin's Funeral March as a ringtone and not give it to the character named Deadman? Die Hardman is particularly bad about this. This motherfucker never stops calling you. Like, when you leave your safe house, he calls you up and says,
Sam, check the terminal for available orders.
Like, bro, I'm like 20 hours into this game. You think I could have made it this far without checking the terminal thing? And then on top of that, he gives you like a briefing of the mission, and when you leave the way station, he calls you again like, hey Sam, I'm pretty bored. You want to talk about the Death Stranding or whatever? Leave me alone! Don't even get me started on these fucking holograms too. Every time you deliver a package, some asshole who you've never seen before stands there and just unloads dialogue onto you, and none of it matters. The only one I would recommend listening to is Conan O'Brien. He's got some funny otter jokes at least. And final complaint, I promise, but this game has way too many cutscenes. And again, I'm not talking about the storyline cutscenes. Those are fine. But like, everything you do has a stupid little unnecessary animation. Like, you can recycle items to get materials at the terminals, and watch how long it takes to do that.
Delivering cargo.
Why? And you might be saying, man, you're pretty impatient, huh? And firstly, yes. But also, like, why? Why are they so insistent on showing me this every single time I recycle materials? I have to skip 4 cutscenes to take a shower. Like, Kojima, I get it. Norman Reedus has a nice ass, but the novelty kind of wears off after the 73rd time, bro. So that's Death Stranding. Is it a good game? Yeah. Or no? I think so. I don't know. Death Stranding is a very weird game. I went into my second playthrough thinking, I'm gonna dislike this game again. And don't tell anyone this, but I kinda came out really liking it. The story makes pretty much no sense, but to be fair, this is Hideo Kojima we're talking about here. Let's not pretend that the appeal of Metal Gear is its cohesive and easy to understand story. But all that said, it's a very interesting story with mostly engaging characters, and I've always been a fan of Kojima's silliness and random out-of-place fourth wall breaks and nonsensical comedic moments anyway, which are in full swing in Death Stranding. The Kojima charm is definitely here. You have several pizza delivery missions, the little robots that deliver packages for you sing and whistle. If BB is happy and you look down at him, he'll give you a thumbs up. Jinji Ito and Edgar Wright are just in the game for some reason. It's great. I've always preferred serious tone stuff when it has some silliness to it. It feels more relatable to me. Even in the worst of situations, it's human nature to make jokes to lighten the mood. And you know, as a game, it's not for everyone. It's really tedious at times, it takes a pretty long time to really take off, the combat is pretty whatever, and the gameplay is quite literally just walking from point A to point B. But when Death Stranding is at its best, there's something really therapeutic and entertaining about it for me. And it's so goddamn atmospheric. The visuals are just breathtaking. The game is full of beautiful, natural, and yet melancholic landscapes mired by gloomy overcast all the time. All of this is topped off by the occasional inclusion of Low Roar's slow, calming, ethereal folk rock tracks that seem like a musical version of what you're looking at. On the other hand, this game has so many cool themes of horror and dread. It really does a great job of portraying so many different moods. You know, I never thought I would say this, but I like this game. It's definitely unorthodox, perhaps even a little bit up its own ass sometimes. Like, I mean, sure, it's got the whole metaphorical thing and the thing about reconnecting the world and stuff like that, but it's still a game where you throw piss grenades at ghosts. Let's not pretend that this is Mulholland Drive. But regardless, I think Death Stranding is a one-of-a-kind game. It honestly makes me kind of sad that I spent the last 2 years hating it so much. I kind of feel like I owe it an apology.
Come up to meet you, tell you I'm sorry. You don't know how lovely you are. I had to find you, tell you I need you, tell you I set you apart. Tell me your secrets, ask me your questions. Oh, let's go back to the start. Running in circles, coming up tails, heads on a science apart. Nobody said it was easy. Such a shame for us to part. Nobody said it was easy.